Well, y'all came back. Y'all must be glutton for punishment. And some of y'all probably said, that white boy's okay. He can tell a joke. Well, tell the truth, I ain't white. Now some of y'all right now is like, your mouth's wide open, say, what? He ain't white? Quit catching flies with your mouth open, alright? I ain't white. I just sound like it, but I ain't. Tell you the truth, I was talking to this lady on the phone the other day, and I was telling her, yes, ma'am, I'll get you that documentation down there as soon as I can. And she kind of laughed about it, you know. I guess she's from the up north. Nobody could actually call her ma'am. But I did. And later that day, I went up there to meet her. Well, her face just dropped, y'all. I mean, she seen me come in here and say, this colored boy done come in here. He sounds like he's so white. Now, she's like, oh, thank you for the documentation. I was like, yeah, here you go. You're welcome. And then I looked at her and said, I bet you anything you thought I was white. And she's like, no. I said, yeah, people get that impression, you know. But it's a little bit strange when you meet me. It's like, you don't sound like what you look like. Yeah, it's okay. I'm a paradox of epic proportion, y'all. Yeah, most people ask me, what is your nationality? Some of them even come out and say, I bet you you're Hawaiian or Polynesian. Yeah, well, you know, I do look it. But mostly I just said, tell them, I'm mixed with black and Asian. Mostly I'll be saying, ooh, that's sexy. You know, it's sexy in some ways, if you're Polynesian. But I just think I'm adorable. A big old teddy bear. I bet you I'll be thinking, well, why do you sound like that? Well, we moved around a lot, so I picked up a lot of different colloquial languages and syllables and whatnot. So it kind of all meshed in there. But I've been living in Texas for a while. And in Texas, it just kind of grows on you. I mean, you one day you be, yeah, I'm from California and surf and beach and everything, and next thing you be calling people y'all and ma'am and be wondering what the heck had happened to you. You became a pure Texican. Yeah, well, it happens. Stay at a place long enough and you start sounding like the people. Well, when you're a little kid and you move around a lot, you tend to make a lot of friends. And I had several best friends. I mean, different states, but I still had several different best friends. So, out in California, I had a best friend. He was kind of weird. His name's Charlie. And I used to hang out with him, but sometimes I didn't hang out with him because I didn't want my other friends to know that I actually hung out with him. You know, y'all have the friends like that, you know. You know, some of y'all have wives or girlfriends like, yeah, I'm going to hang out with the boys, but you don't tell them specifically who you're hanging out with, because they know if you're hanging out with that person, they're just 100% pure trouble and get you in trouble. Yeah, y'all know what I'm talking about. Well, Charlie, he was a little bit different. He wasn't like that, but he was a little bit different. Well, in this particular school district, there weren't that many black kids. Mostly whites, Hispanics, and Chinese and Asians, you know, a little mixture there. Well, one day, I kind of got in a fight. It wasn't really a fight because it really didn't start, or didn't end up like a fight. It's more like an amusing little beat down. But what happened was, here I was with my little friends, you know, a bunch of little black kids, and there was this kid, you know, the white kid with his friends. So we're about to throw down. And next thing you know, out of nowhere, Charlie came up and said, oh, you're messing with my boy. So I was like, yeah, okay, what the heck is he doing here? And next thing he said, I'm here to represent. I was like, and everybody looking at him like, okay, what the heck is this little Chinese kid doing here? Who he representing? And next thing you know, everybody's looking at him like, what are you doing here? Well, the next few words came out of his cello's mouth was, I'm here to represent my brothers and sisters. And he put his arm around Tracy. Okay, you gotta realize something. Tracy, she was like the toughest girl there, the toughest black girl there, but she was really cute, but size didn't really matter with her. Well, when he did that to her, well, the beatdown started. I mean, she kicked him, smacked him around, beat him up. Everybody stood around just watching, was dumbfounded that, you know, here's this little Asian kid getting beat up by this girl. Okay. And now, I don't know what happened, but all I know is Chow, he's like born in the wrong body. Wrong skin, actually. He's like ghetto boy, but he's Asian. But anyways, now Tracy, her last name is Lee. Apparently they grew up and I don't know, she gave in, they got married, they have kids, they're wonderful people. But Chow, he's, oh man, the weirdest kid growing up, but it was still a pleasure to know him, you know? Well, you guys know how y'all like to plan little things for your ladies, you know? You guys know, you know. Okay, I have a friend, Pratish. He's Indian. He's a pretty cool guy. Anyways, he decided he wanted to plan something for his wife, okay? Well, he planned something. It was something interesting, alright? It was more like a little strip routine, and you gotta realize, Indian people, they are kinda modest people, and well, he's more like the new Indian guy, more Americanized. Well, he did some a little strip routine when he came home for his wife. Well, unbeknownst to him, his in-laws were there, and they came out of the back and living room and were standing behind him while he was doing his little routine. And it was an eye-opener for a lot of them.
What is it?
Well, it's nothing more to have your in-law see you stripped down to your underwear. Well, he no longer surprises his wife. I wonder why.